I'm often on first at these events, I think the idea is that I wake people up, metaphorically or otherwise. So I'll do my best on that front. Having been a DJ for the past 30 odd years, I've found myself immersed in sound. And in recent years, I've studied some of the dynamics of sound. And I've come to recognise that it can be weaponised against the people. But equally, it can be used for great healing and great upliftment, because the opposite is always true in any situation. We live in a world of duality and polarities. So I'm going to get the doom-laden stuff out of the way first off, in terms of how sound has been weaponized, and then we'll move on to some of the more positive applications for it as we progress through. So, I'm not usually in the habit of quoting the BBC when it comes to sources of great truth. However, there was a documentary a few years ago put out called Tunes for Tyrants, hosted by Susie Klein. And in it, she's talking about how music and sound has been weaponized at a military kind of level. And this intro to that documentary sets the tone very much for the content that I'm going to present this morning. So let's take a listen to this.
And Lenin was far from the only political leader in the 20th century who understood and tried to exploit the power of music. What fascinates me is music's uncanny ability to stir us up, to calm us down, to express every possible human emotion. It bypasses language and reason and aims instead directly for our souls. And that's what makes music so incredibly powerful and also potentially incredibly dangerous.
So I think the BBC connection to expressions of truth probably stops there. But it was a pretty good start, right? So sound weapons are indeed a very real thing, which have been used at a military level. This document, this article, talks about at higher volumes, infrasound of around 7 to 20 hertz. Isn't it interesting that sound frequency is measured in hertz? What's in a word? It's almost as if the clue is in the name right there. So 7 to 20 hertz can directly affect the human central nervous system, causing disorientation, anxiety, panic, bowel spasms, nausea, vomiting, and eventually unconsciousness. Supposedly, 7 to 8 hertz is the most effective, being the same frequency as the average brain alpha wave. So there are sound weapons which have been used in situations where the powers that shouldn't be have wished to disperse crowds, such as at freedom rallies, that sort of thing. And when these things are used, they can cause these bowel spasms that this article talks about. They can also cause people to vomit and basically shit themselves. It affects bodily functions at a very base level. And this is where we're dealing with very low frequencies, very low on the range. The idea of sound weaponry even made it into the Tintin comic book series, which I used to love as a kid. There was one book put out by Hergé, the author, in 1954 called The Calculus Affair, where the Professor Calculus character is experimenting with the machine that we see here in his laboratory, and it's being developed as a potential weapon to destroy cities in the story. So it's designed to make buildings crumble and the foundations shake, because the weaponry is used at a very low frequency, which affects such things. It's in recognition of the fact that everything in this apparent physical reality is in fact sound and light energy vibrating at an endless array of frequencies. And when it comes to apparent physicality, these are very low, dense vibrations. That's the kind of range that they're interested in at this level. So that weapon, which was portrayed in that Tintin story, is based on a very real one. And in the book, it makes reference to this other book by Leslie E. Simon, a much sought-after post-war research into German World War II experimental weaponry. And the book was titled German Research in World War II. So this was a very real thing which was being developed with the potential to destroy buildings and cities. In the music industry itself, there have been references to sound weaponization, and we get one of them through the video to the Kate Bush song Experiment 4 from 1986. So Kate Bush is an artist who knew a thing or two about a thing or two. Many of her lyrical themes are fascinating. They hint at her having been inducted into circles where she had direct access to hidden information, which the rest of us are only just catching up with through our research now. But way back in the 80s, she was putting all this stuff into her music. Here's one of the lyrics. The song starts, "We were working secretly for the military. Our experiment in sound was nearly ready to begin. We only know in theory what we are doing." What could possibly go wrong? "Music made for pleasure, music made to thrill. It was music we were making here until they told us all they wanted was a sound that could kill someone from a distance. So we go ahead and the meters are over in the red. It's a mistake in the making, you don't say." So I've got a small excerpt from that music video from Kate Bush right here. And the video itself makes for interesting viewing. So that's the first clip. Kate Bush had an affiliation back in the 80s with a lot of the actors from the comic book series and Blackadder and such. So Dawn French is in that video, Hugh Laurie, I think Robbie Coltrane is in it. And she did that sequence with Rowan Atkinson at Comic Relief in 86. But we go further on in the video, and what we find is that these government scientists who are messing about with sound, they don't really know what they're doing, in the process of this experiment, they've conjured up some sort of demonic entity which possesses the scientists, kills them all, and runs rampant through the research facility. So we start to see that aspect unfold in this part of the video. To the end to get that nice sonic shush sign from Kate, indicating some of her connections possibly. I'm not going to do the shush sign myself because somebody will take a photograph of me, post it online and claim I'm a secret Freemason. It has happened before, trust me. So I'll avoid that one. So these scientists have been working at such frequencies as to form a connection with some sort of entities which have then been allowed to come in. This guy, William, I always have trouble pronouncing this name, Schoenebelen, I'll just call him William S, that's better. So this guy was a so-called Illuminati Druid. So he describes himself as someone that was working for all the wrong people on the dark side. He was raised in one of those sort of bloodline families where he was inducted into these sort of secret society mystery schools. He saw the light, so to speak, and became a born-again Christian, and in so doing became also a whistleblower, where he revealed many of the secrets that he'd learnt during his time in the cabal. He spoke a lot in this interview excerpt that I've got about sound and the various methods and tactics that he used, again, to weaponize it to do great harm to large numbers of people without their conscious knowledge, because it's all happening at a subconscious, below the radar level. So in this interview excerpt from a radio show that he did some years back, he goes into some of that.
Why is all this modern music so loud? Well, there's a reason for that. It has a soul-destroying effect. It really does. And all this has been planned out in advance. It really has. And, you know, I can remember when I was a witch, because when I was a witch high priest, I could see auras. And the aura, I believe, is just an expression of the human soul. And the aura is an expression of the person's state. And I would see these young members of our coven. I'd tell them, don't go to these, like, horrible concerts. Don't go to, you know, like, at that time, the punk stuff and the Sex Pistols and that kind of stuff was really popular in the late 70s. And I said, don't go to these things. They'll damage your soul. And they just laugh at me, and they go, and they come back, and their auras literally look cracked. They look shattered. And there was all these things on them. We call them larvae. They're like spiritual parasites that attach to these people's auras. Now, of course, these weren't Christians. These were witches. And their auras were not in probably very great shape to begin with. Yeah. But the point is, it was horrible what this music did to them. And when I was trained all this as a bard in the Druidic Rite, it was explained to me that that you could literally flay somebody's soul alive with music, with the right kind of combinations of sound, of volume, of timbre, of you know, the amplitude, the wavelengths, all of that stuff. It's a science of spiritual attack and spiritual destruction.
Exactly. In short, everything you hear coming out of the average teenager's mobile phone these days, right? So he goes into some of the various dynamics that are used consistently by the music industry deliberately to cause dissonance and discordance in recorded music. One of them, which has been used for decades, is the sawtooth wave, so-called. This is what it looks like on an oscilloscope, which is used to measure sound frequencies. It's pretty ugly, and it sounds the same way. William S. went into that further in this particular interview, The Occult Power of Music, where he said, it's a very disagreeable sound. It's almost like the sound of fingernails on a chalkboard. And what I find extremely interesting is that, with the advent of the electric guitar, some of the fuzz effect and all those weird sounds that people like The Who and Hendrix and all these early pioneers of rock music would do, a lot of that involves sawtooth waves. That would not be, in my estimation, by accident. Another tactic which has been used is the tritone. This is described as an interval between notes, which is three whole tones apart. And the reason it's so dissonant is because the brain, when it's listening to music, to rhythm, is expecting notes to fall in a certain order. And when they don't, it causes discordance by throwing a curveball at your consciousness. So your brain is trying to fill in the gaps, but it's undergoing cognitive dissonance because it's not hearing what it expects to hear. So the tritone goes all the way back to the days of classical music. We're going back several centuries. It was described as the devil's interval by the Catholic Church at the time. They'd know all about that. Because it was considered to induce psychosis in large audiences when they heard music produced in that way. So again, according to William S. there, the very intro to Purple Haze by Jimi Hendrix is cited as using what's come to be known as the tritone or the devil's interval. The tritone is reputed to have been banned by the Catholic Church, because they're just nice people that want to help us, you know. when its use in the classical music of the 18th century was deemed to be disharmonious and has generally been frowned upon by scholars and musicologists since. It speaks volumes, excuse the pun, that it's been greatly favoured by some of rock's more raucous performers from the 1960s onwards. Therefore, Black Sabbath's eponymous song is said to offer another prominent showcase of the tritone, along with much of the output of Slayer. Possibly not too much of a surprise there. But I've also heard it suggested that the theme tune to The Simpsons also employs the tritone. And given how many millions of people around the world view and have viewed The Simpsons, that's quite a formidable audience. So as mentioned, the intro to Purple Haze, the very famous song by Jimi Hendrix, is said to include the tritone. It's got it embedded into the intro. Would we like to hear it? I think we would. I've lined it up in anticipation. Here's how it sounds. So that's said to be a generally disharmonious sound. And to the conscious mind, it might not appear that way. That's a very popular song. It's a great rock song. Many of us, I'm sure, like it. But we don't realise that this stuff is going on below the surface and can be affecting us in very profound ways if our consciousness is not engaged and if we're not aware of what's being done. I'm bringing in here this concept of the million song data set because it speaks to contemporary modern music. A lot of people ask me why I don't do videos exposing the contemporary music industry, stuff that's around at the moment. And the answer simply is because I can't bear to put myself through the ordeal of listening to it. I leave that to other researchers. My research tends to stop round about the late 90s because I lost interest in popular music then anyway. Taylor Swift, exactly. Case in point. I talk about her when I do my presentations on mind control, but other than that, I leave it alone. So yeah, modern music just doesn't do it for me. It's all digital, it's all electronic. It just sounds completely homogenized. It sounds completely horrific to me. I have no interest in it. And I think there's a reason for that, because I'm picking up on some of the stuff that is happening at that unseen level in this dreadful stuff that's around at the moment. So going further into this, I've got a short video here from Paul Joseph Watson. So he's not a guy that I particularly resonate with. I don't particularly like his output, but he was bang on with this video from a few years ago when he was talking about some of these dynamics which are routinely employed in the corporate music industry. And he's talking about that million song data set, and he's explaining in this short clip basically why modern music is shite.
Popular music is dumber, duller, and more homogenized than ever before. This isn't a matter of taste or subjective opinion. It's an objectively provable fact. A 10-year analysis of songs that spent 3 weeks or more at number one on the Billboard charts found that song lyrics are getting measurably less intelligent. Chart toppers in 2006 read at a third to fourth grade level. 10 years later, the intelligence of song lyrics has dropped by an entire grade. The way this trend's going, in a few years, song lyrics won't even be a challenge for 7-year-olds to understand. The study found that Beyoncé, Lady Gaga, Kesha, and Maroon 5 song lyrics are particularly stupid. Researchers in Spain, who used a huge archive known as the Million Song Dataset, also found that pop music has become blander. Studying pop songs from 1955 to 2010, the team discovered that the diversity of transitions between notes, chords, melodies, and other sounds has diminished over the last 50 years. The Spanish study also found that producers a baking volume into songs at the production stage, making them artificially louder. This overcompression has the effect of sucking all the dynamics out of a song. Everything is beginning to sound the same. Individuality is being drowned out. In fact, pop music is now so devoid of originality that producers are using computer algorithms to determine which track will be commercially successful.
Right, so that video clip was from around 5 to 6 years ago. So at that point, he wouldn't have known that artificial intelligence programs are going to be employed or are being employed to literally write pop songs. ChatGPT and these other various applications. I was at the Glastonbury Symposium last weekend. Anyone else there? No? Okay. Great event. Great presentation on Saturday by Andy Thomas, the host of the symposium. And he was talking about AI and its dangerous incursions into our lives. And as an experiment, he had used one of these AI programs online and asked it to write a poem which included Christmas and crop circles, just to see what it would come up with. And he then presented the results, and the poem included elements of those two subjects. And I've got to say, it was pretty impressive. It was a pretty good poem. It was all in rhythm and all in rhyme, and it included the themes that he'd asked it to. And that was produced by a computer. So that stands as proof that songs can literally be produced in this way and now are. That's why they all sound so bland and so dreadful. Many of us are picking up on this, I'm sure. Often when I hear one of these contemporary pop songs, I sound like an old bastard, you know. I know I sound like my dad 30 years ago moaning about the music that I listened to, but the music that I listened to was good, as opposed to today. So I do find myself sometimes in the unfortunate position of being in a car, or maybe I've walked into a shop or a cafe and they're playing some of this stuff. And it really does put me on edge in a way that I can't describe. It just makes me want to get out of there because I can't stand to listen to it. I experience the same thing with a lot of ads. If I'm listening to a radio station, which I don't do much these days, but the ads come on, there's something about the sound frequency that just don't make me feel good. They put me in a state of anxiety. So it's all to do with the frequencies, it's all to do with stuff that's happening on an unseen level. And with modern music now, of course, it's all digitally produced. So whereas analog methods of production used to be used, real musicians, real living men and women creating this stuff, now of course it's electronic programs. And the way that music is delivered and listened to now is all electronic and digital in nature as well. So most young people experience music now in the form of MP3s, listened to on their phones. Not the best way to listen to music, but that's the way it's getting done. And the process of encoding an MP3 tells us a lot. So you have a large file with a full frequency range recording. Everything is there. That's how you start out. Might be a WAV or an AFE file. And then a program such as iTunes, which I use, will create an MP3. And these can be various different sizes. It can go all the way down to 128 kbps or even less, which is an extremely compressed file. And by the time you get to that stage, what's happened is the program has stripped out a whole load of what was there in the original recording. So you don't notice it when you listen to the song, unless you've got an extremely trained ear. But the program will look at the sound wave, and it will take out a part of the bass line or a part of the top end or something which it deems indiscernible to the human ear. And to most people it is. So what we've got there is large chunks of the original recording missing without anyone noticing. And it strikes me, again, in this world of polarities, that if that dynamic can be the case, then the opposite must also be true. In that you must be able to strip stuff into sound recordings without anyone noticing. Frequencies, different elements of the recording, you won't necessarily notice that it's there, but it can be having an effect on you. AI used to create new and final Beatles songs, says Paul McCartney or whoever it is. That's another talk. So, of course, why wouldn't McCartney slash Billy Shears be wheeled out to push this particular psyop? So what happened was there was a recording of a demo song by John Lennon, which he made in 1978, very rough vocals. And these vocals were plugged into an AI program. McCartney added his vocals, they added the instrumentation, and they effectively created a new, in inverted commas, Beatles song 40-odd years after John Lennon died. And McCartney's crowing about how great it is that AI can now do this. I would disagree about it being great. but it does stand as an example of what's now happening. So the idea to use AI to reconstruct the demo came from Peter Jackson's eight-hour epic, Get Back. For the documentary, dialogue editor Emily de la Rey used custom-made AI to recognise the Beatles' voices and separate them from background noise. It was this process that allowed McCartney to duet with Lennon on his recent tour, including at last year's Glastonbury Festival and for new surround sound mixes of the Beatles' Revolver album last year. So we're moving now into elements of another presentation which I delivered a couple of years ago, which was titled Mind Control Through Electronic Dance Music, because this is where a lot of this stuff gets done. Some of you may have heard the recent series which I put out, four episodes titled The Second Summer of Love. So we're on the 35th anniversary right now of the summer of 1988. Which was dubbed the Second Summer of Love by the media of the time. This was the acid house rave scene in the UK, which gave birth to the explosion in electronic dance music and clubbing culture, which was exported all around the world. I was caught up in that whole thing. Maybe some of you here were as well. I'm sure we all had some great times, probably in marquees such as this, in fields such as this. But a lot of research, which I and many other researchers have done recently, has shown that that whole scene bears all the hallmarks of having been yet another social engineering psyop. Why would that even be a surprise anymore? And what it led to was this export of electronic dance music all around the world. In many ways, you can trace the roots of it back to what happened in 88 and 89 right here in Britain. I feel the Tavistock Institute, note the t-shirt, would have had a thing or two to do with that, because they're generally involved in psyops of this nature. But what also struck me was that the late 80s scene seemed to be a recreation, a reboot of what had happened in the 1960s. In California, primarily, but there was a British version of it as well, the counterculture, flower power, hippie scene of those times. So in the late 60s, you had changes in culture, changing attitudes to music, to drugs, to family, to relationships, to sex. And that was all fermented to a very large extent by expressions of the military. The CIA in America had its fingerprints all over this one. When you contrast that with what happened in Britain in the late 80s, you've got so many of the same elements. So in the 60s, the drug of choice, the mind-altering drug of choice, was LSD. In the 80s version, it was ecstasy, MDMA, appearing in seemingly unending quantities at all these dance festivals and in the clubs. And many of these routes lead back to government military sources. Then you've got electronic dance music, this new revolution in sound and ways in which people are enjoying music, which contrasts with what was happening in the 60s, psychedelic rock and folk rock and country rock and all these different styles of music which had come to replace what had been there previously. And then in the 60s, you had all these hippie festivals and music gatherings, and in the 80s, that was the raves, the warehouse parties, the open-air raves, and then eventually the superclubs. So it strikes me that all the same dynamics were in place, and the social engineers of this world would never pass up an opportunity to mind control huge numbers of young people, because it's always the youthful generation of any given time that they've got in their crosshairs. They want young hearts, young souls, young minds, because they're much easier to mould and manipulate than when you get grizzled and cynical and jaded at my kind of age, right? But I was caught up in the earlier one. So we're discussing that in the Roundtable podcast series, which I've recently put out on my platforms. I'm having a discussion there with Dom and Chris of Sheep Farm Studios. Who listens to Sheep Farm? A few of you. Okay. Definitely recommend listening to these guys' podcasts. They do impeccable research. Well, Dom does anyway. Chris just drinks wine and comes in with the odd quip. But great research. But the important thing about their podcasts is they're delivered with great humour. These guys have a bit of a laugh. They take the piss out of people like Klaus Schwab and Bill Gates, because who really can take them seriously? And it's pretty much the only podcast I now listen to, because I find all the others to be pretty doom-laden, pretty depressing for the most part. Either that or they're full of false hopium and wild bullshit claims. But I like Sheep Farm because they're bang on the money with their research and it's delivered with great humour. Also in these shows was Matt Sergiu of the Occult Beatles and Conspiro Media Sites, another formidable researcher. Got a little audio clip here from one of these shows that we put out where we're going further into what I'm talking about here.
Well, the thing with Decca is it had, and I say had because, as I say, it's not really, it's still around as a label, but it's not as big as it was. It had military connections. It dealt with radar. It began to, in the 1940s, it developed radar during the Second World War for, I think, the UK and both the US, but I'm not exactly sure. And then right after the war, it decided to really invest in radar and make it an arm of its company. So as well as releasing music, it was also developing and manufacturing radar. And one of the products, if you like to use that word, products that it was manufacturing, as Keith Richards says, was a product, if you like, an invention, a gadget, a device that was being used in Vietnam to bomb the Vietnamese. And it was a radar system that was attached to helicopters, I think it was. And Decca not only manufactured and produced these and delivered them to the US troops in Vietnam, but they also supplied the US troops with Decca staff, Decca radar staff, in order to train the pilots on the helicopters how to use the radar.
It's amazing, isn't it, Matt, that some of these labels like EMI worked with Marconi that then developed the frequencies that they put into TVs and telecommunication systems. So a lot of these military weapons were then utilized in the mass media that we use today, TV screens, radio, whatever.
So he's talking there about the military applications of many of these early record labels. And this is something that's come up in my research. It's in my first book. I came across this about 15 years ago. Many of these labels that were responsible for putting out the first rock and roll superstars like Elvis Presley, the Beatles, the Rolling Stones. We're talking labels like RCA, which stands for Radio Corporation of America, which was developed by the American Navy. Also, we've got Decca, which Matt was talking about there, EMI, Parlophone, these sort of labels. And all of them, before they became record labels putting out music by the likes of these artists, were engaged in experimentation in sound. Radar systems, sonar systems, different radio technologies, vinyl formats for records, this sort of thing. So all roads consistently lead back to the military, and there are never any exceptions. So this is the scene of 88, 89.
Is that you?
No. No, that's not me. I was around in those times, but it's not me. And one figure who connects the 60s counterculture psychedelic scene and that 90s club culture scene is Terence McKenna, a consciousness guru to many. He's talked about entheogens, so-called psychedelics. He's talked about having had experiences on psilocybin mushrooms and LSD and mescaline and peyote and all these other different compounds, some of them natural plant medicines and some of them laboratory produced. But he's talked of the connectedness that we all have with everything else in creation and how that can be achieved through imbibing plant medicines. So for many, that's a very positive message and it all sounds very inspiring. But I did discover something about him through research which came from Jan Irvin, who used to have a show called Gnostic Media Unspun. He did a series of podcasts with Joe Atwill, and Jan Irvin used to experiment with plant medicines and entheogens himself, so he's got a lot of experience in that area, and he knew a lot about Terence McKenna. So we get on to an audio clip that I've got of McKenna shortly. But what's important here is that in 1992, by which time club culture in the UK had really taken off, we were starting to get super clubs like the Ministry of Sound. Ministry of Sound, what's in a name? Actually sounds like a government department. And Cream and, you know, clubs like Gatecrasher were on the way. So in 92, the acid house rave scene had really kick-started what was to follow. And in that year, Terence McKenna did a series of lectures titled Evolution. And in this clip here, he's directly tying that culture and that scene in with the earlier one from the 60s. So he says, with electronic culture, you can create shamans for the global planetary village. And this, to my mind, is the function that rock and roll played in the 60s and that house music should play in the 90s. Through emphasis in house music and rave culture on physiologically compatible rhythms, sound, properly understood, can actually change neurological states in large groups of people getting together, creating a telepathic community of bonding that hopefully would be strong enough that it would carry the vision out into the mainstream of society. All right, so this audio clip is one which was brought to my attention by Jan Irvin when he started to do some deep digging into Terence McKenna, and he discovered an admission from McKenna of him having been effectively on the payroll of the FBI. So this calls into question how genuine and how sincere the messages that he put out into the world really were. Did he start out genuine, and was he co-opted at a particular point? Or was he always a man on a covert mission? Those questions remain, but let's listen to some words from the man himself. This was a lecture that Terence McKenna delivered at the Esalen Institute, which studies consciousness and spirituality, in California in 1994.
And certainly when I reached La Chorrera in 1971, I had a price on my head by the FBI. I was running out of money. I was at the end of my rope. And then they recruited me and said, you know, with a mouth like yours, there's a place for you in our organization. And, you know, I've worked in deep background positions about which the less said, the better. And then, you know, about 15 years ago, they shifted me into public relations, and I've been there to the present.
So McKenna's defenders have attempted to say that when he talks about they recruiting him, he's talking about the mushrooms. But I'm not sure that mushrooms have a public relations department. It's pretty clear to me what he is talking about there. Another interesting character is Moby, the dance music producer and DJ. World famous, not by accident. He comes from a Freemasonic family. It's a long-running bloodline. His real name is Richard Melville, because he is descended from Herman Melville, the writer of the Moby Dick story, hence his artist name, Moby. There was another BBC documentary which did have some interesting nuggets in it a few years ago called How Dance Music Changed the World. It came out on BBC 4 in 2017 and it included some comments from Moby. I've got a clip from that here because I find what he had to say extremely interesting and actually consistent with how I feel this scene is being used.
If we were doing this interview 10,000 years ago or 20,000 years ago, because clearly we had swimming pools and digital cameras 20,000 years ago, you might be asking me, oh, what do you think is compelling people to bang on logs and dance around a fire? Well, lights flicker in their eyes. You just also describe modern dance culture. So an anthropologist could use those same terms to describe music and dancing and hedonism 20,000 years ago or 5 minutes ago.
And I think he's really onto something there. So he's talking about this natural inclination within the human condition towards dance, rhythm, a communal atmosphere, sharing experience with others, altered states of consciousness achieved through entheogens or other types of drugs, and that spirit of togetherness. So all those elements might have been present in a tribal community, as he says, 20,000 years ago, where they would be dancing around a fire while a shaman is banging out rhythms on a drum, and they're sharing that experience together under the influence of plant medicines, probably. Then you can think about the 60s with that hippie scene, these festivals, many of the scenes described by Dave McGowan in his great book Weird Scenes Inside the Canyon, where he documents that whole mid to late 60s scene and some of the crazy stuff that used to go on. The same elements are there. The drugs, the music, the rhythm, the togetherness, the festivals. And then contrast that with the rave scene. Scenes that we were getting in 1988, 89 and beyond, where large numbers of young people had been coerced into getting together, dropping ecstasy, altering their consciousness, listening to these electronically produced rhythms and dancing together in a communal setting. What I think the social engineers were trying to tap into was that natural gravitation that we all have towards those type of scenarios. They just wanted to package it in a certain way and be in control of the whole process. And that's what we saw with this second Summer of Love scene. There were some very interesting comments made by Danny Rampling, who was one of the pioneering DJs behind that scene. Danny's become a friend of mine in the last couple of years. He's a very rare entity, a well-known household name DJ that's had the courage to stand up and speak out against tyranny and against the attempted theft of rights and freedoms. But Danny was right there at the start, and he's credited with having been a big part of kickstarting that entire scene. And in an interview that I saw that he'd done with The Guardian in 2007 to mark the 20th anniversary of the birth of so-called acid house culture, he spoke of a harmonic convergence, which he said was taking place in August of 1987. It's some sort of planetary conjunction. Others could explain the exact dynamics far better than me. But August 1987 is the month that was given for this mythical trip that four young DJs, no pun intended, took to Ibiza. This was Danny Rampling, Paul Oakenfold, Johnny Walker and Nicky Holloway. And they're said to have undergone this sort of spiritual epiphany when they were dancing open air under the stars to sounds spun by DJ Alfredo at Amnesia Nightclub under the influence of MDMA. And they brought that whole experience back and exported it to London and started some of those early acid house clubs. So August 1987 was the time when this so-called harmonic convergence was starting to take place. It's a consciousness shift by any other name. And wouldn't it be just like the controllers that we currently have, the dark occultists, to know that one of these is on the way because they study such things, and rather than let it go its own way in a natural grassroots fashion, to be in control of it every step of the way. And I feel that's what occurred. What that whole scene led to was what we have now, these huge, large-scale festivals all around the world, dance music events. It becomes very interesting to look at the names of many of these events. So Dream State in California, Trance Nation in the Netherlands. Trance is an entire genre of dance music. It's literally called that. Velvet Hypnotized in Bali, Atlantis in Australia, Spring Awakening in Chicago, Awake in Dresden, not our kind of awake, more sort of woke awake, you know? Awakening Fridays in LA, Dream Beach in Spain, Delirium Eternity in Argentina, Electronic Family, Digital Society, Digital Dreams, Tomorrow World in Atlanta, Tomorrow World in Belgium, Future Music Festival in Australia, and New Horizons in Jakarta. So first off, note the geographical spread of these events happening everywhere from Dresden to Australia. And then look at some of the overtones of the names. So we've got some very strong hints at transhumanism and this futurist AI-controlled society, Tomorrow World, Digital Society, Electronic Family, this sort of thing. And then you've got references to trance and hypnosis and being in these altered states of consciousness. So that's what these events are designed to achieve on somebody else's terms. There was a chat thread on David Icke's website some years back where former ravers and clubbers were talking about the effect that they felt some of this stuff was having on them. Now that they're in their later years, they can reflect soberly on what they were a part of. So comments include, when the music got more and more hardcore, some of it used to make me feel like it was trying to take over my mind. Not sure how to explain the feeling, but I remember being at a rave and not liking what the beat was doing. So I'll leave that stuff there because I do need to make sure I leave enough time for the positive stuff, right? The uplifting stuff. So let's go there now Because of course, everything in life, everything in this existence is a choice. It's always a choice. So in the same way that sound can be used to induce great harm, so it can be used to bring healing and upliftment. What I've got here is an excerpt from a documentary which was put out by Gaia TV a couple of years ago, and this one sets the tone for how I want to take the direction of the rest of this talk.
In the beginning was the Word. And God said, let there be light.
Most in the West are familiar with the Christian concept, in the beginning was the Word. God spoke the Word and the world into existence. What most don't realize is that, for example, in ancient Egypt, they taught the same thing. There was Ptah, the god of technology, who went into his heart and felt the world and then spoke it into existence.
Almost universally, ancient texts and traditions have always placed sound at the core of not only our existence, but the existence of the entire universe. And it begins with the powerful seed syllable, the ancient Om, which originally was never spoken, but it was felt in the body. And this is where the relationship between sound and vibration becomes very important, because ultimately sound is only a vibration brought into an audible range.
Right, so it's all about frequencies and vibration. This brings in the infamous subject area of 432 versus 440 hertz, which has come up endlessly in my research. This is the pitch to which recorded music is set and musical instruments are tuned. For many decades now, the standard tuning frequency has been set at 440 hertz. Musicologists will tell you that that's actually a very harmful frequency. The natural one that we should be listening to music at is 432 hertz, and this always used to be the case. So there's some conscious musicians who do still set their music to 432, but most of the recorded stuff that you hear is going to be set at 440. I find it very interesting that 432 falls into an amazing numerical cosmic sequence, which I've featured in my talks before. It's all centered around the number 9. It always reduces back to 9, which itself has a value of 0 when it's added to anything and then reduced back down. It's a unique number in that regard. This particular sequence begins with 27. We can think of the 27 Club in music industry research, which is the large number of musicians who've turned up dead at the age of 27 in suspicious circumstances. But I've got here some examples of how different expressions of this sequence just keep cropping up. 54, 108, 216, 432, 864. So 216 can be expressed as the 21st of the 6th, 21st of June, that's the summer solstice. And there are just endless expressions of this sequence, and 432 falls into it. So I'll speed it on and just lead it on this one. A mind blower comes from applying Jewish gematria to the word Jesus. Doing this gives us a numerical rendering of 45666. And if you multiply all these together, you end up with 43,200. There's the 432 again. We can't talk about sound frequencies and the effect that sound has on consciousness without considering the work of the Japanese scientist Dr. Masaru Emoto. So his studies involved exposing water to sound and also words. It wasn't necessarily spoken sound, it could also be written words because of the energetic frequency that that word carries, the intent that it carries. So what he would do was expose water to these different sounds, these different words, then freeze it very quickly and produce crystals. And the idea was that the consciousness of the water had absorbed some of what the sound represented.
This photo is water exposed to Chopin's
farewell song. I think we'll skip the video because we're a bit short on time. But here are some of the examples of how the crystals looked after they'd been exposed to certain words. So we've got things like thank you, wisdom, truth, eternal, and you've got these beautiful geometric patterns which form. And then when the water was exposed to phrases like, you make me sick, evil, then you get these horrible, discordant patterns, designs, which are anything but harmonious. So water has consciousness, and again, it brings us back to the fact that sound is present everywhere within this realm of existence. Here's another clip from that Gaia TV documentary, which pretty much puts a lid on things.
So it seems that no matter where we go or what time period, there's a belief that sound was fundamental to creation.
And equally remarkable, our own genesis as human beings may well have started in a similar way.
When that embryo becomes less than a millimeter in size, right? Very close to a millimeter, but not quite a millimeter, the embryo already starts to develop the first aspects of the inner ear. So the very first sense organ that is developed within the embryo is the inner ear.
Sound is the first sense to develop in the womb and the last sense to go when we die. Many ancient cultures had practices for midwiving birth and death using sound, music, spoken or sung prayers, knowing the importance of these critical thresholds.
So the takeaway from all this, sound turns out to be quite important. Memories of music cannot be lost to Alzheimer's and dementia, says this study. If you're especially into a piece of music, this is research from Dr. Hans Utter, who did a lot of shows with Jan Irvin. Your brain does something called autonomous sensory meridian response, ASMR, which feels to you like a tingling in your brain or scalp. It's nature's own little buzz, a natural reward that is described by some as a head orgasm. According to a recently published study in the Journal of Prevention of Alzheimer's Disease, the part of your brain responsible for ASMR doesn't get lost to Alzheimer's. Alzheimer's patients tend to put people into layers of confusion, and the study confirms that music can sometimes lift people out of the Alzheimer's haze and bring them back to at least a semblance of normality, if only for a short while. So people that have been in long-term comas have been known to come out of them when they're exposed to a favourite piece of music. It just gets into areas of the brain that nothing else seemingly can. And what Hans Utter was talking about there, this little buzz that you get when you hear a favourite piece of music, explains why we get the goosebumps sometimes. You hear a tune that takes you back to a particular time, and you can remember vividly the people that you were with, a relationship you were in, where you were living, what you were doing. All those memories come back from just hearing that piece of music, and you get that little tingle going up the spine as well. It's a very powerful thing. So ultimately, everything is a decision, and we've seen some very horrific ways in which sound can be weaponized against us, and has been and is, so it pays to be vigilant towards that. But equally, it can also be used for healing and great upliftment. So the social engineers, the occult, satanic controllers of organized society have made their choice as to what they want to do with sound and frequencies and such. But we, collectively, have the opportunity to make our choice. We don't have to buy into all that stuff. We don't have to be affected by it. We can make better decisions, and the opportunity is there to be tapped into anytime we choose. You are free to choose, but you're not free from the consequences of your choice. Let's make better decisions when it comes to music, sound, and frequencies. Thanks for listening. Brilliant.